Tribe by tribe, his kingdom grows. Through clever diplomacy and brutal warfare, he extends his power throughout Ireland. Entire kingdoms submit. Connacht, Meath, and his old enemy, Leinster, whose king pays Brian a crippling tribute. In the year 1002, in the hills of Munster, a new summit is scaled. Brian has claimed the ancient title of Ardrí, High King. Ireland now has, in fact, what it once had only in theory, one ruler. For the next decade, Ireland enjoys unfamiliar gifts, peace and prosperity. Brian rebuilds the churches and restores plundered treasure. He constructs roads, bridges, and waterways throughout Ireland. To ensure the coast is no longer troubled by Viking raiders, Brian enlarges his navy, based on the River Shannon. All the while, former rivals, surrendering but not submitting, bide their time. As Brian enters his eighth decade, old enemies imagine the old man weak. In 1013, the King of Leinster forges a pact with Sitric Silkbeard, the Viking King of Dublin, and both provinces rise in rebellion. The rebels have misjudged the old man. Brian spends the winter raising an army. From all over Ireland, loyal subjects answer the High King's call to war. Brian even enlists Viking mercenaries, the finest horsemen in the land. The rebels recruit just as furiously. The Viking Sitric Silkbeard sends for help to his brethren across the sea. Earl Sirgard the Stout of Orkney, Brodar of Man. By the spring of 1014, Dublin Bay is swarming with Viking longships. It is the greatest force ever seen on the Irish seas. In Brian's camp, on the eve of battle, the old warrior speaks to his men. At dawn will come their chance to rid Ireland of the Vikings once and for all. North of Dublin, at a place called Clontarf, a Viking army beaches its ships. Here on Good Friday, 6,000 heathens face 6,000 Christians. Too old to fight, Brian pins his hopes and the command on his son, Murca. Murca himself will strike the first blow. The great battle opens with a contest between champions, waged in the no man's land between the armies. Already a great warrior, Murca now proves himself a worthy leader.
Stefan! 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 Stefan!
Gradually, the two armies draw closer. In both armies, the best warriors march in front. Shoulder to shoulder, they form a solid wall of shields. On the flanks and rear of the Irish line march the kerns, farmers by trade, soldiers for the day, hurling javelins, darts, slingshots, and stones.
They are quicker and more expert than any other people in throwing stones, and such stones do great damage to the enemy on engagement.
As the armies collide, the battle turns into a brawl. Swinging a sword in each hand, Murca strikes a great blow by cutting down a Viking chieftain, Earl Sirgard the Stout. Brian sees the Viking fall, but then Mirka's flag falls too. The old man's son is dead.
The two sides made a furious, smashing onset upon each other, and there arose a frightful screaming and fluttering above their heads as birds and demons awaited their prey.
All through the day, the battle rages and the casualties mount. By evening, the Irish break through the enemy line. The Vikings flee toward their ships and safety. But this Good Friday is a black day for them. At Dublin Bay, the tide has come in. The Vikings are cut off and cut down. At the water's edge, the Vikings give up their claim to Ireland. Brian gives thanks to God for his victory. Yet in his hour of triumph, disaster strikes. In the confusion of battle, Brodar of Man and a handful of Vikings escape and stumble upon the king. Hardly believing his luck, Brodar falls upon Brian's bodyguard and cuts his way through. Before the old man is even aware, Brodar beheads him. So passed the greatest warrior and greatest Irishman of his age. When Brian's men captured Brodar, they were so enraged that they tied him to a tree with his own intestines. Brian died in his finest hour. He had united his people and rid his country of invaders. For the first time, and for the only time, all Ireland had been set free.